welcome to our service this morning. It's the 23rd Sunday in the season of Pentecost, and that means that next Sunday is the last Sunday of the church year, the Festival of Christ the King. The theme of the readings this morning is persecution and perseverance. That Christ told us that we would experience persecution in this life, and that we should persevere in faith through the difficulties of life. Let us stand and sing our opening hymn, which is number 543, Onward Christian Soldiers. We'll just sing the first four verses.
First four verses. Thank you.
readings this morning really portend the coming of Advent, and which of course refers both to the first coming of Christ at Christmas and also to his second coming in glory to judge the living and the dead. Hear the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place, but the end will not follow immediately." Welcome, dear friends. It's lovely to see you here on this Remembrance Sunday. Remembrance Sunday is not a liturgical occasion. It's not part of the church year, but of course it's part of our social year. It's part of our societal remembrance and thanksgiving of those who have made the ultimate sacrifice and given their lives for that we may be free. Maybe turn to one another and say good morning and welcome to church. It's lovely to see you here this morning. Welcome this morning. We turn as good Anglicans to page one in the prayer book as we greet one another with the Trinitarian greeting. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray the collect for pure hearts as we say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We declare together the hymn of the heavenly host as we say together, Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you. We give you thanks. We praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
We
turn to the bulletin sheet to page one for the collect or theme prayer for today. It's a very famous collect, this one. Let us join together as we pray the prayer at the bottom of page one on the bulletin, saying together, Blessed Lord, who cause all holy scripture to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading from the Old Testament by Professor Glenn McCartney, the Honorary British Consul. Thank you, Glenn.
Thank you. The Old Testament reading this morning is taken from Malachi 4, verses 1 to 2. See, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all the evildoers will be stubble. The day that comes shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. And for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Glenn. And there you have it. The theme of today's readings and today's service as we approach Advent is that the day of the Lord is coming, which will be a terrible day, the day of judgment. But for those who revere the name of God, the Son of Righteousness will rise. So there is persecution and trouble coming, but joy will be at the end. Let us turn to the psalm then on page 2. And as we join together, as we say it from side to side by whole verse, beginning on this side. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things.
With his right hand and his holy arm, yes, he won over himself the victory.
The Lord has made known his victory, his righteousness has he openly shown in the sight of the nations.
Remember his mercy and faithfulness, and all the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God.
Shout with joy to the Lord, all you lands. Lift up your voice, rejoice, and sing.
Sing to the Lord with a harp, with a harp and a voice of song.
With trumpets and the sound of horn, shout with joy before the King, the Lord.
Let us sing and make a noise in all the earth again. Lands and villages are well buried.
Let the rivers clap their hands, and let the hills ring out with joy before the Lord, when he comes to judge the earth.
In righteousness shall he judge the world, and the peoples with equity.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle reading read by Eileen Stowe. Thank you, Eileen.
The epistle reading is from 2 Thessalonians, verse 3, 6 to 13. Now we command you, beloved, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to keep away from believers who are living in idleness and not according to the tradition that they received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you, and we did not eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labour we worked night and day, so that we might not burden any of you. This was not because we do not have that right, but in order to give you an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this command. Anyone unwilling to work should not eat. For we hear that some of you are living in idleness, mere busybodies, not doing any work. Now such persons we command and exhort in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly and to earn their living. Brothers and sisters, do not be weary in doing what is right. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's stand and we'll sing our gradual hymn number 604, tune 109, Soldiers of Christ, Arise, 604. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke chapter 21, beginning at verse 5. Glory to you, Lord Christ.
The destruction of the temple is foretold. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." And then he speaks of signs and persecutions. They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'The time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name. But not a hair of your head will perish, and by your endurance you will gain your souls. The destruction of Jerusalem is foretold. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation has come near. Then those in Judea must flee to the mountains, and those inside the city must leave it, and those out in the country must not enter it. For these are days of vengeance, as a fulfillment of all that is written. Woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing infants in those days. For there will be great distress on the earth and wrath against this people. They will fall by the edge of the sword and be taken away as captives among all nations. And Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled." This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord, we ask that we may indeed have hearts that are set on peace and trust, that whether waters rise or armies rage, we may know that you hold us in the everlasting arms, and that, as Jesus says, not even a hair of our head will be destroyed ultimately, but we will gain the salvation of our souls. We ask that we may have such faith, that we may not be perturbed by disease or troubles or disasters or wars, but that we may put our trust ultimately in you and in your eternal salvation. In your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated, dear friends. Well, it's really lovely to see you all. This is one of the Sundays in the year when everybody dresses up very beautifully. And so thank you for coming to honor the occasion. It is a very special occasion for us in Morrison Chapel as we are able to process down to our cenotaph, so to speak, and to lay a wreath in thanksgiving for those who have made sacrifices that we may be free. As I often share with you each year, I don't take these things lightly because My father fought in the Second World War in the Empire Air Training Scheme. He was trained in Canada, and then he was a navigator in a Halifax bomber flying out of the UK during the latter part of the war. And he told me as a boy that at that time the crew's life expectancy was about 3 months. They would not expect to live longer than 3 months. And he came into the war in the last year, so he was very lucky, because he flew in the last year, but his crew survived. Dad's crew were a crack crew, and because they were so good at their job, they were a bomber crew, they would always drop bombs on strategic targets. It troubled me terribly as a child that my dad had bombed Germany, in the innocence of youth. And it's an understandable concern, I think, as well. But he said, oh no, he said, we always bomb strategic targets. We were bombing bridges and factories and armaments. And he said also, he said, we knew that Hitler, we knew what Hitler was, and we knew he had to be stopped. They used to get newsreels in Australia of what Hitler was doing to the Jews and to others and to the people of Europe. And they were honored to be able to participate. My grandfather lied about his age and signed up in the First World War and went and fought in the trenches in Europe. And I'm very proud of both of them. And I understand that there are times when one needs to defend the innocent against the bullies of the world. And so I feel this is a very significant occasion for me personally, as well as for many of us here, as we give thanks for the sacrifice of that generation in both wars, but also in other wars which have been fought for freedom. I know it's a difficult subject, but I think you understand what I mean. Now, as I mentioned earlier, this is not a liturgical occasion, so there are no readings for Remembrance Sunday. And so each year, Remembrance Sunday falls on different Sundays in the liturgical calendar around this time of year. It could be the 20th Sunday in Pentecost, or the 21st, or as today it's the 23rd, it's quite late. And so the readings change, and today the readings seem quite random. We have this lovely epistle that Eileen read so meaningfully, urging us not to be busybodies and lazy bums, and that we should work for our living. And you think, well, what does that have to do with Thanksgiving, with Remembrance Sunday? And the answer, of course, is really nothing, really. But it is an exhortation to live meaningfully and constructively in the last days. Today's readings are pointing us to the second coming of Christ and to Judgment Day. Unfortunately, the gospel today is particularly confusing, and the readings therefore follow as being somewhat confusing. And the reason that they're confusing, I think, is that Luke was confused himself. This is my own theory about this. Because in his chapter 21 that we've read part of today, Luke mixes up four different things, and they're all mixed up, juxtaposed. You get one thing and then the other thing and then back to the first thing. And it's not clear to me that Luke understands the difference between these different events that he's describing. So I want to just unpack them a little bit today for us so you can understand them a little bit better. And you really need to refer to all of chapter 21. It's a very, after verse 5, which we start with today, it's a very difficult chapter, really. So thanks to those who wrote the lectionary for giving us a tricky set of readings for Remembrance Sunday. I think one way in which it connects to Remembrance Sunday is that these images of the end times conjure up for us images of conflict, of war, of devastation, of sudden calamity, as you will hear. And these, of course, relate to us to our experiences of the great wars and our ongoing experiences of war, as now in the Ukraine, for example. Calamity comes upon us suddenly and in overwhelmingly destructive form. And these themes relate to the reading today because it speaks about the end of the age and the coming of the judgment. So let me go back to Luke chapter 21 and just clarify for you the four concepts which Luke has put together. Whether he understood that they were separate or not, I'm not sure. But the way in which they're all kind of mixed together like a cake in this chapter makes me think perhaps he didn't fully understand. And of course, we have the benefit of hindsight, because one of the concepts that he includes is the concept of the destruction of Jerusalem, which was to take place some years after he was writing. So there's no way that he could have understood that Jesus' prophecy about the destruction of Jerusalem was just about to take place in a few decades. There's no way he would have understood. He would have understood that as referring to the end of the world. When Jesus talked about those, you know, woe to the pregnant woman and woe to the nursing mothers, don't go into the city, and if you're there, get away, run to the hills. He would have thought Jesus is talking about the end of the world and the judgment day. But of course, Jesus wasn't. He was talking about the destruction of of Jerusalem and the visitation of God's judgment upon the nation. So let me untangle for the four strands that I think are mixed up in this chapter. The first is an Old Testament concept of Yom Yahweh. I've mentioned this before, the day of the Lord. Now, the Jews regarded time in two ages. They believed that there was the present age in which we live, which was pretty much altogether evil, and in which Israel struggled to hold its place in the world against many enemies, pretty much how things still are, surrounded by enemies. This is an age which is incapable of being cured, except by the coming of the King, the Son of Man that Daniel spoke of, the God-made man who would come into the world and establish a kingdom that would never end, the Messiah, in fact. So they understood that the time was divided into the present age and the age to come. And those two ages, the present age and the age to come, the watershed point between the two ages was Yom Yahweh, the day of the Lord. That the Lord would come in human form, Emmanuel, God with us, the Messiah, and he would usher in the age of the victory of Israel, of the establishment of the kingdom of God. It would be a day of cosmic upheaval and destruction, of desperate birth pangs of the new age. Now there are three things, this is still point one, okay? There are three things about point one that the Old Testament, this is an Old Testament concept, and Jesus built on it, as you'll see. Three things about the Yom Yahweh is, number one, it was going to be scary. Isaiah 13 tells us, "Behold, the day of the Lord comes. It is cruel with wrath and fierce anger to make the earth a desolation and to destroy sin from it." So you can see this is not a pretty picture. Another verse from Joel chapter 2. "Blow the trumpets in Zion." Zion is Jerusalem. "Sound the alarm on the holy mountain. Let the inhabitants of the land tremble. For the day of the Lord is coming, a day of darkness and gloom, of clouds and thick darkness," and so on in the same vein. In Amos chapter 5, it says, "Woe to you who long for the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? The day of the Lord is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion or went into the house and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and gloom with no brightness in it?" Cheerful picture, right? So it's scary. Zephaniah goes on, Zephaniah chapter 1, "The day of the Lord is near, a day of wrath, of distress and anguish, of ruin and devastation, of darkness and gloom." So this is one of the concepts which comes up in Luke's gospel, and it goes on and on in a similar vein in Zephaniah. It's great stuff. So the first thing about the day of the Lord, Yom Yahweh, is it's going to be scary. The second thing about the day of the Lord, using a little alliteration, is it's going to be sudden. It's going to come unexpectedly. And we see that the apostles, Peter and Paul, pick up this Old Testament Jewish theme and they relate it to the second coming of Christ. So Yom Yahweh is equated to the return of Christ in the future. They saw that when Jesus came, he brought the gospel of love. He didn't bring darkness and gloom and judgment and so on. And so they thought, well, this must be still coming. And so we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, "The day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." So they're still expecting it, but it's going to be sudden. And then in Peter, St. Peter writes, chapter 3, verse 10, Peter 3, verse 10, "The day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything that is done in it will be disclosed. All things will be revealed." So it will be scary, and it will be sudden, and the third thing is it will be shattering. Now, this is very much like what the people of Kiev and of the Ukraine and Donbas and so on have been going through. They've been going through a time of darkness. It's been frightening. It's been sudden. And it's been shattering. On the theme of shattering, Isaiah, going back to the Old Testament, Isaiah 13 says, "I will make the heavens tremble and the earth will be shaken in its place, and the wrath of the Lord of hosts in the day of his fierce," as at the wrath of the Lord of hosts, "in the day of his fierce anger." So it's a day of God's judgment, of God's righteous wrath upon the sinful world. He says, and in Joel chapter 2, "I will show portents, signs in the heaven and the earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke, and the sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes." So we have, you know, Christian folk running out and looking at the blood moon and say, "See, you know, the Lord is coming again," which is exactly what Jesus told us not to do. And then in 2 Peter 3, finally, On the day of the Lord, the heavens will pass away with a great noise. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything that is done in it will be disclosed. So you have this terrible idea of a day which is scary, it's sudden, and it's shattering. And it's going to come, as it were, the judgment day of God upon a sinful world. Now, I think one of the reasons why the early church struggled with this is that Jesus himself and the apostles pointed forward. They said that the day of the Lord hadn't fully come. However, as Christians, we understand that the day of the Lord had come. It came, of course, on Good Friday. The wrath of God was poured out on Jesus on the cross. The fire, the immolation of God, was poured out on Jesus' life. He was the sacrifice which was, as it were, immolated, burned up on the cross for our sin. The darkness of God descended upon the nation on Good Friday, you remember. For 3 hours there was darkness over the land. So the signs of Yom Yahweh were fulfilled on Good Friday at the first coming of Christ. But Jesus also said that it was in the future at his second coming. He pointed forward. So it's like, actually, there are two Yom Yahwehs. For those of us who believe in Christ, in fact, one of the readings said this. For those of you who, where was that? The first reading, "For you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings." So for those who, I think the idea is that for those who revere the name of Christ, Yom Yahweh has already come. It's fallen on Jesus for our salvation, for our sake. And so for us, the coming of the Lord will be the rising of the Son, S-U-N, or for us, S-O-N, of righteousness with healing in his wings. But for the unrepentant nations of the earth, it will be Yom Yahweh, the original plan, plan A. It will be a day of judgment. Of course, we don't know what it will be because it hasn't come yet. We have the benefit of hindsight about the prophecies of the destruction of Jerusalem, but we don't have the benefit of hindsight of the second coming. So that's the first concept, Yom Yahweh. And as you can already see, just the first concept is quite sophisticated and complex. For us as Christians, I believe it's come on Friday on the cross, but it's also still yet to come in the last judgment, what we call the last judgment. Okay, now, secondly, the second concept which is wound into this chapter is the fall of Jerusalem, and I've already mentioned that. And in fact, as we said, in around 70 AD, Jerusalem fell to the Roman armies after a desperate siege in which the inhabitants were actually reduced to cannibalism, as often happens in sieges, and in which the city of Jerusalem was literally taken apart stone by stone. And if you've ever been to Israel and Jerusalem, you know that there are those enormous stones of which the Second Temple was built, and all that remains is the Wailing Wall, the Western Wall of the Temple. And all the other stones of the temple, just as amazing, were pushed down. In fact, you can still see the dents in the ground that the stones made. These stones were so big that when the walls fell, they dented the ground, and the dents are still there. The furrows are still there. The Romans were remarkable engineers, both at building and at destruction. And when they finally defeated the Jews and destroyed Jerusalem, they did it with a vengeance. They deconstructed it stone by stone, except for the Wailing Wall, and they sowed Mount Zion with salt so that nothing would grow there. They were very thorough. You've got to hand it to them. It's said by Josephus that over 1 million people died in the siege, and that 100,000 were taken away, 97,000 were taken into captivity. And the nation was obliterated, and of course never recovered until the 20th century. Very thorough work. The temple was fired and became a desolation. So we read in Luke chapter 21 today, verses 5 to 6, when some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these stones that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another, all will be thrown down." It's a remarkable prophecy from the early first century, and it's been remarkably fulfilled. But Luke would not have understood that it was about to come. He thought probably that it was referring to Yom Yahweh, to the day of judgment and the end of the world. So he couples it together with the speech about the judgment day. Luke goes on in verses 20 to 24, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, know its desolation has come near. Those in Judea flee to the mountains. Those in the city leave it. Those in the country must not enter it. For these are the days of vengeance, as is written, for all that is, as a fulfillment for all that is written. Woe to those who are pregnant, to those who are nursing. There will be great distress on the earth, and so on. They will fall by the edge of the sword and be taken captive. These prophecies of Jesus came true in spades. And we have the benefit of hindsight, so we can unravel it. And we can say, oh, that's not the end of the world, that's the destruction of Jerusalem. The end, albeit of their word, the world, temporarily. Thirdly, the third concept that's woven into this chapter is the second coming of Christ. Jesus is talking about his return, and he relates it to the idea of Yom Yahweh. He was sure that he was to come again, and that the early church was waiting for that to happen. And it will often help us to understand that New Testament passages about the second coming include much of the older imagery, which had to do with the day of the Lord. And that imagery was taken and attached to the second coming of Christ. So in Luke 21, 27 to 28, it clearly refers to the return of Christ. It says, they will see the Son of Man. So this is Jesus talking. And he says, they will see the Son of Man. That's me. That's him. They will see me coming in the clouds with power and great glory. Now he's talking about his return. He's not talking about this Old Testament concept. He's not talking about the destruction of Jerusalem. He's talking about his second coming, which obviously hasn't happened yet. And he says, the Son of Man will come with clouds, with power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand up, lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. In other words, it's a good thing. Get ready. I'm coming again. Before the second coming, it was expected that many false claimants to Christ would arise. And so in verses 7 to 9 we read, they asked him, teacher, when will this be? What will be the sign that it's about to take place? And he said, beware you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, I am he, and the time is near, but do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be afraid, do not be terrified, for these things must take place, but the end will not follow yet. So the first concept is the Old Testament concept of the day of the Lord, the dividing day between the present time and the kingdom come. The second concept is the fall of Jerusalem, which we can easily dismiss and deal with. It's done. And the third concept is the second coming of Christ. But there's a fourth concept. And the fourth concept is that before Christ comes, the church will undergo great persecution. And there will be great suffering in the world before the end of all things. And Christ comes to heal and to redeem the world. So Jesus foresaw and foretold that terrible things, persecution, would come, and that people would need to persevere. They would need to stand firm. They would need to stand shoulder to shoulder. And they would need to have a faith in his salvation and eternal life. They would need to be not afraid. They would need to be people of courage. And they would need to understand that the enemies of Christ can destroy the body, but not the soul. And they cannot destroy our hope of the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. So in Luke 21, verses 12 to 19, we read, before all this occurs, before the Lord returns, they will arrest you and persecute you. So here it comes. There will be persecution. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons. You will be brought before kings and governors. Now, of course, when Jesus had ascended, all these things began to happen right away. They were being arrested. They were being persecuted. For the first 300 years of Christianity, Christians were being put to death left, right, and center. But what many people don't know is that in the 20th century, more people have been arrested, tortured, persecuted, and martyred than in all the other 19 centuries put together. I've often mentioned this to you. So we live in an age in which this prophecy of Jesus is being fulfilled more than at any other time in history, numerically more. So before this happened, they will hand you over, you'll be brought before kings and governors. And then he says, so this is an opportunity to testify. This is an opportunity to preach the gospel. So make up your minds, don't prepare a defense. I'll give you the words, I'll give you the wisdom to say to your enemies. You'll be betrayed even by parents and siblings, relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. And you will be hated by everyone because of my name, because you follow Christ. But not a hair of your head will perish. I think that's a reference to the resurrection of the body. Of course, some of their hairs perished. But by your endurance, you will gain your soul. So Jesus is saying, persecution is coming. Be prepared. But I will see you through to eternity. He's saying, it's not about this life. It's about the long game. It's about the victory ultimately in eternity of the resurrection to eternal life. So these four things are mixed up in this chapter. And when you read it, it's kind of unhelpful in a way, because Luke can't tease them all apart. How could he? But we have the day of the Lord, the future fall of Jerusalem is mixed into that. Then we have persecution that will come, and then the second coming of Christ. And they're all here in this chapter. Now let me just say, conclude with a few comments about the passage. In the story, Jesus is commenting on the splendor of the temple. It moved Jesus to prophesy about its destruction. The irony, the second temple was one of the greatest wonders of the ancient world. The pillars and porches of the cloisters were columns of white marble 40 feet high, each made carved of a single block of white marble. Of the ornaments, the most famous was a great golden vine, which was made of solid gold, and each cluster of grapes was 6 feet high, 2 meters high. So this was a huge golden sculpture of the vine, which is a symbol, of course, of Israel. And the finest description of the temple is found at the time, is found in Josephus. Of course, we can't see the temple because the Romans destroyed it. They pillaged it and took it away and destroyed it. So we can only go back to Josephus in his Wars of the Jews, Book 5, Section 5, where he writes, "The outward face of the temple in its front wanted nothing that was likely to surprise men's minds or their eyes. For it was covered all over with plates of gold of great weight. And at the first rising of the sun, it reflected back a fiery splendor and made those who forced themselves to look upon it to turn their eyes away, just as they would have done at the sun's own rays. But the temple appeared to strangers when they were at a great distance, like a mountain covered with snow. For as to the parts that were not gilded, they were exceedingly white, white marble." It was unthinkable to the Jews in the time of Christ that the temple should be thus destroyed within their lifetime. It was unimaginable to Luke that this could be a historic event. He thought this must be the end of the world if this happens. From this passage, we learn four basic things about Jesus and about a Christian life. These are very quick. Number one, Jesus is the Lord of history. He saw what was coming, both in the short term and in the long term. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of Man. He is the one who knew and who sees. And he told us not to be afraid. Wars will come, famines will come, earthquakes will come. He says, hold fast, stand firm. Secondly, he's the Lord. So first, he's the Lord of history. Second, he's absolutely honest. He doesn't pull his punches. He says, this is what's going to happen and this is how it's going to be. He says to his disciples, this is what you must expect if you want to follow me. It's not going to be easy. People are going to hate you for my sake. They're going to mock you and persecute you. Once in the middle of a great struggle for justice and freedom, a heroic leader wrote to his friend, heads are rolling in the sand, come and add yours. Jesus believed in men enough and women enough to offer them not an easy way, but the way of heroes. And this morning we remember the heroes, those who went to add theirs in the sand. Jesus was honest. Thirdly, Jesus promised that we would never be alone. It's the sheer evidence of history that the great Christians have written over and over that even when they were being tortured or put to death for their faith, they had a sense of the sweet presence of Christ. A prison could be like a palace, a scaffold like a throne, and the storms of life like beautiful summer sunshine when Christ is with us. This is the testimony of the saints and martyrs. Fourthly and lastly, Jesus spoke of a safety that overpasses the threats of life. Not a hair of your head, he said, will be harmed. This is obviously some kind of hyperbole, some kind of metaphorical allusion to the resurrection of the body. But nevertheless, it's an assurance that he will carry us through the fire. In the days of the First World War, Rupert Brooke, young, beautiful English poet who died early on his way to Gallipoli, out of his own faith and ideals, wrote these lines, and I'll close with this morning, from Rupert Brooke, who Queen Elizabeth quoted, I might add, in 1947. "We have found safety with all things undying, the winds and mourning, tears of men and mirth, the deep night, the birds singing." So he's talking about men at war, and he says, "We have found safety in the undying things, the wind." So the soldiers in their trenches, enjoying the wind, the mourning, the tears, M-O-R-N-I-N-G, the tears of men and mirth, laughter, the deep night, and the birds singing, and the clouds flying. This is in the midst of war, the darkness of war. "And sleep, and freedom, and the autumnal earth. We have built a house which is not for time's overthrowing. We have gained a peace unshaken by pain forever. For war knows no power. Safe shall be my going, secretly armed against all death's endeavors. Safe though all safety's lost, safe where men fall, and if these poor limbs die, safest of all." The one who follows Christ may lose their life, but they can never lose their eternal soul. Amen. Dear friends, as our custom is, let us turn to the prayer book, to page 4. And as Jesus urged us, we stand firm. Stakete and kraitete, we stand firm and we hold fast. And we declare our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. As we say together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made a man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. The third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We have acknowledged one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Dear friends, please be seated or kneel as you prefer, as Freddie comes to lead us in our intercessions today. Thank you, Frederick.
For the intercessions, we will use Form 3, found on page 31. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word.
We pray for all who govern and ask that you grant wisdom to world leaders in advancing efforts toward world peace. We pray for those who hold authority also in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer, in particular those who are troubled by ongoing conflicts and war, and those who suffer grief and trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Father, on this Remembrance Sunday, we pray for those who have died in the line of duty and the service of freedom, and ask that you give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Hasten, Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who live by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. I would just mention that today is the day when the Anglican Communion prays for us. So all over the Anglican world, 80 million Anglicans are praying for Hong Kong and Macau today, which is a comforting thought, I find. As we prepare our hearts to break bread together, hear the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor as we pray the corporate confession on page 6 in the prayer book, saying, "Most merciful God, dear friends, hear these words of absolution. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. May we stand for the greeting of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with a shalom, the peace of Christ. Peace be with you. Please be with you, dear friends. Please forgive me if I don't work the aisle today. Please be seated for a moment. So we just want to draw your attention to the announcements in the bulletin. Again, thank you all for coming out and looking so lovely. In your bulletin is an insert which has a little colour on it. It's got a poppy on the back, and that was we will take it down. Also, please take your hymn book with you. We're not singing "God Our Help" today. We're singing a different hymn as we process down for all the saints. But you'll need your hymn book with you. There's a lot of verses. And then please, at the end, bring the hymn book back to the chapel. So maybe, Cyril, we could put the seismic trolley outside so when people come back, they can bring the hymn books back for morning tea. And I'm told that we'll have morning tea outside in the sunshine this morning. Isn't that lovely? I'd like to thank in advance Dr. Nathan Kwan, who will play a tune for us on the pipes called "The Flowers of the Forest." This is traditionally played all over the Commonwealth as part of Remembrance Day observances, and is simply called "The Lament." It is the standard tune, so Nathan doesn't get too many chances to play it, so this is the time, the golden moment, to play that tune. So thank you to Nathan, and also thank you to the principal trumpet, David, who is here to play the bugle for us. So it's lovely to have you with us, as always, again. I am looking for testimonies from men in the spirit of Movember, our Friendship Sunday on the 27th in 2 weeks' time. I'm looking for a few good men to share the testimonies of their faith, how they come to faith in Christ, or of something Christ has done in their life at our Friendship Sunday at our second service. You need to please try to write it out, or to write some bullet points at least, so I can see them before we let you loose, as it were. Thank you. I didn't do this once, and we got a 50-minute rave from somebody. So, our 200th anniversary, not of the chapel, but of the worshiping community, is this year. And so we've decided to make our Christmas lunch a combined anniversary celebration. And we've been able to increase the number of places to 204 by including a private room that's attached to the main Chinnery Ballroom at the Artisan Grand Lapa. I'm sure you won't mind having your lunch in a private room, but it's right next to the main room where the service will take place. So on the 18th of December, there's no service here. The service will be not at 9 or 11, but at 10 a.m. Now, the service is open. Anybody can come to the church and sit around the edge and join the service. But if you want to stay for the lunch and the shenanigans afterwards for the 200th anniversary, you must sign up. The person to sign up is Anya. Anya, can you wave a hand, please? So she will be happy to take your money or your deposit and your name and phone number. So if you want to join the lunch, please sign up. When we had our 10th anniversary of our second congregation, we had 240 people came. And this time we have 204 places. We've already sold almost 100. So in two Sundays, we've sold half the places. So if you want to come, sign up today and avoid missing out. Now, the price is dirt cheap because somebody is going to pay more than half of it. We have a donor who's covering most of the cost. So for 150 mop, you get a five-star Christmas lunch with all the trimmings. So do sign up. Children 0 to 5 are free. Good news there for Liana. And she's 0 to 5, right? Are you 0 to 5? You're also free. And if you're 6 to 12, six to 12, it's only 50 mop. So very good deal. So do please sign up. Don't miss out. We would love to have at least a table from Morrison Chapel, if not two. It would be wonderful. Because after all, it's celebrating, you know, 200 years, and it's an international church worshipping in this place. So it's a great anniversary for us to celebrate. And we will be giving you an anniversary gift of a red and gold 200 years mug, 1880, whatever it is. Mass was not my strong suit. What are we now? 1822, thank you, to 2022 mug, which are made, they're ready, they're here, thank goodness, they're here, and they're ready to go, so. All right, so don't miss out on your mug, but you have to buy a seat at the lunch. By the way, we're not inviting friends, because we have too many congregants, so please don't invite friends yet. If we don't fill the seats, we'll open it in a couple of weeks to friends. But at this moment, it's not an outreach, it's an in-house, it's for our church family to celebrate together. Okay, I just commend to you all of the other notices. There's a lot happening between now and Christmas, so do please have a look and keep us in your prayers at this busy time. There's a lot happening in the church. Let us stand as we sing our offertory hymn, which is number 617, Stand Up for Jesus, number 617. Thank you.
Christ, if I saw your banner,
page 8 in the prayer book. Let us offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good our promises to the Most High. We pray together, yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
All things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right to the good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy,
subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will
together, we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him.
Sanctify us
also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament,
and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace,
and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom.
All this
we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours.
Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
We turn to page 22, and as our Savior Christ taught his disciples, we are confident to pray, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen."
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
We do not
presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord,
trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies.
We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs on your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in you, and he in us.
Dear friends, the gift of God for the people of God, his body broken and his blood shed. Let us take them in remembrance that Christ died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We do invite you, if you are baptized and have faith in Christ, to join with us at the Lord's table today. Regardless of denomination, all are welcome at his table. Dear friends, let us turn to page 25. You will be hated by all because of my name. But not a hair of your head will perish, and by your endurance you will gain your souls. Let us give thanks for these mysteries we have received as we pray. pray the prayer on page 25 of Thanksgiving together. We say, Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food
in the sacrament of body and blood.
Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And I will not say the blessing at this time because we have another part of the service with the blessing at the end down at the cemetery. So we will now sing the hymn, so you need to take up your hymn book, hymn number 148, For All the Saints, and we will follow the cross and we will continue to walk out and down as we sing. So I will do my best to sing out, but I need your help.
Thank you.
Let us please stand as we sing For All the Saints, 148. of remembrance insert in your bulletin, and as usual, the Honorary British Consul will read the poem, which is the so-called act of remembrance itself. First, the call to remember. Let us remember before God who commend to his shore-keeping those who have died for their countries in active service during wars, and those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of humankind. The call, the act of remembrance.
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
Laying of the wreath. Observe the 2 minutes of silence. Michael will play the lament.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, from whose love in Christ we cannot be parted, neither by death nor in life, hear our prayers and thanksgivings for all whom we remember this day. Fulfill in them the purpose of your love, and bring us all with them to your eternal joy. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, we give you thanks for the many blessings with which you have enriched our lives.
Thanks be to God.
For those who serve in the armed forces, on land, sea, and in the air.
Thanks be to God.
For doctors, nurses, chaplains, and all who minister to those in need or distress.
Thanks be to God.
For the sacrifices made, especially in two world wars and in all subsequent wars.
Thanks be to God.
For all the organizations that care for the casualties of war. For the Red Cross and the agencies that provide relief to victims of war.
Thanks be to God.
May God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the Church, the government of Macau, the Commonwealth of Nations, and all mankind, your blessing, peace, and concord, and to us and all his servants, life everlasting, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, come down upon us and remain with us always.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, dear friends, for coming to honor this occasion with your presence. I would like to especially thank David and Nathan for their wonderful contributions, and of course, Maddie, as always, and Natalie. Thank you, dear friends. I regret very, very much that I cannot stay and eat the King sandwiches. I have to go because I have to do this again for the children at the second service, so they know. So please excuse me if I scurry off and have a sandwich for me. And thank you very much to the Honorary British Consul, always reminds us and gets us organized, and for bringing the morning tea. Thank you, Glenn. Bless you, friends. And have a lovely day on this glorious morning. Please enjoy the garden for a moment. Isn't it beautiful?